Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our service at Harbor of Hope this morning. Just want to greet everyone in the name of Jesus. A few things. Youth social, Friday evening, March the 8th, and then church games night the 15th. And I guess there's some other stuff coming down the road. You can see them and you can make a note of it. And then birthdays. Okay, last week was Colt. And do you usually sing the ones this coming week, or how do you do it? Or you do it twice now? Well, we can sing for Colt and then happy birthday.
Can we also sing to Jasmine, because she wasn't here last week, so she never got sung to, and that was a big 13th birthday, so we better sing for that.
Do you want to start it?
Sure. Happy birthday to you.
Okay, any other announcements that anybody wants? If not, I'm going to try to keep my devotional short, but it's coming from a book I read while I was in Florida, Don't Give the Enemy a Seat at Your Table. And there was some pointers that I'm still learning to do properly. But it's written by Louis Gigolo, and they were going through a rough time in their church, and a friend emailed him or texted him 9 words, "Don't give the enemy a seat at your table." That was his encouragement to go on. And he wrote a book on it, and he's done it very good, but I'm going to jump to the back of the book, more on it's the garden of your mind of how to overcome some of our struggles. But he writes in here, "The table, this table that we're sitting at, is in the presence of the enemies because God wants you to know that you'll always have enough for every moment, every struggle. He'll sustain you in every dark night. God wants the enemies to watch you shine. Why? Because in time, they will stop gawking at you and turn their attention to the one who has the ability to keep your face beaming." Romans 14:11, Philippians 2:10 and 11. "Lastly, the table is in the presence of your enemies so they can hear your song. With your eyes locked on Jesus, your worship will be uninterrupted and your worship will become your weapon. Not only will God be exalted, but the chains will break as you fight with this declaration. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I am surrounded by you, Jesus." So if we can remember that when we're in tough times, we're just living in this world. And a good picture of it is how it is in Job, when God and Job, or God and Satan meet up, how God boasts about Satan there, and then he is allowed to do pretty well everything what God says he can do with Job. But keeping on this thought, he talks about your garden as your mind as a garden. Seeds can flow in on the wind or be dropped by birds or scattered in your garden by any number of things. But you as the gardener are responsible for what grows there. You have the power to water the good seeds and cultivate the good seeds and pull out any weeds that come from seeds you don't want. How do you cultivate, weed, and water the garden of your mind? Romans 12:2 says, "Do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." And I'm just going to read that in a few different versions. And the NIV would, various, I think that's what he's using. I'm not going to bother rereading that. But the New Living Translation brings it out a little different. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind you will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then when you learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. And something that stood out to me is this word copy, like the other translations use conform. And back when I went to school, you didn't have copiers that you could just copy your paper and get a new one. They usually made a master copy and had this duplicator, and they'd run it through there, and they'd be smudged and all that. And if you wrecked it, you'd have to go back for another one of them. But now you can copy your stuff, and it's very easy. And the copiers are very good nowadays. If you smudge them, that'll all come through too as well. But how much do we copy from the world in our minds, our way of life? And I'm just talking about myself, and when you, it is a lot. And then he goes on, and he's got seven seeds from God that you can do, and I'm only going to share two this morning, because if I share all of them, I'd probably not get done. But so he says to start small. Realigning your thinking with God's thinking is a process, so take one step at a time. Take one thought each day. Dwell on that thought. Memorize the scripture. By the end of the week, you will be well on your way to cultivating the garden of your mind. Or maybe you just want to take one thought and verse each week for 7 weeks. Either way, plant and begin to cultivate these seven thoughts in your mind now. Personalize these statements for yourself and memorize these verses. And another thought I was going to, when I was thinking of this, it's we sow a thought and reap an act. We sow an act and reap a habit. We sow a habit and reap a character. We sow a character and reap a destiny. And that is the process of sowing. But I'm thankful, too, that if we make mistakes in our sowing, that we have Jesus, the one we can go to, and he will wipe out that sowing we did. But sometimes there's still reaping consequences from that. But the first thought here is, I am in God's story. The story of you are part of God's larger story. The story is bigger than you. Ultimately, the story is not about you. You have been invited into the story of God's great glory and grace. It's all about him, but you have a seat at his table. Before you were formed in your mother's womb, God knew you. Jesus, the good shepherd, guides you always, and the Lord makes firm the steps of those who delight in him. Psalm 37:23. So plant this thought in your mind by memorizing this word. I know I have plans for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Jeremiah 29:11. You matter to God, but the ultimate meaning won't come from putting the spotlight on you. Your life will have the greatest significance when you choose to make it about the one who welcomes you into his never-ending story. And that is so very true. And sometimes in Jeremiah 29:11, I know I have great plans for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you. And sometimes in my life, I maybe would have taken the word prosper to be wealthy, material, whatever, but I think Maybe for myself, I know I should be prospering more in spiritually, growing closer to God, knowing more about that. And there was another thing I was going to read, and the Christian Bible study Bible would say this about the mind. We should experience a progressive transformation of renewing our mind. The mind is changed by prayer, by reading, and to reflection on God's word, by worship, and by meditation on God's act as the Holy Spirit works in us. And this is all something that we can't do by ourselves. We need the help of the Holy Spirit. And Jesus gave us that helper when he left this earth. The second seed would be, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. You weren't born by a random act of the cosmos. God made you with intention, and God made you wonderfully. God has redeemed you and knows your name, Isaiah 43:1. So plant this thought by memorizing this verse. You were created in my utmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. Psalm 139, 13 and 14. You are not the maker. You are made. God is not created in your image. How you might think he should be. You are created in his. He decided that he wanted you in this universe. He imagined and fashioned you. You are not accidental nor incidental. You are divinely crafted. Plant this seed every day. In time, you'll have an oak providing the shade for you and those around you. You begin to believe that you are who God says you are, unique, special, and valuable. And that goes for each one of us. And that is something, how we are created. We have the ability. We don't all have the same abilities, but we are to use the abilities that he has given us with his help. Shall we pause for a word of prayer? Our Father in heaven, we come before you with thanksgiving. We thank you. You are creator. You are the one who planned the plan of salvation. Had this great love for the whole world that you send your only begotten Son into this world to redeem us. We just thank you so much for us. And as we read through here, you have made each one unique and created them for your honor and glory. We just pray as we go forth that we would continue to look to you to guide and direct us. We just pray as we look through your scriptures that you would help to refine us and that we can have a garden that is pleasing to you. We just pray for the service this morning. We pray for the worship team. We just pray you bless them as they share and bless Phil as he shares. We just thank you for each one that came out, and we just ask your blessing on the service. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen.
Well, good morning to each one and welcome. Good to see each one here. Invite you to worship together with us this morning. Invite you to stand as we sing our first song. It's a chorus, four verses, short chorus. Sing together. Oh, come, let us adore him.
Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ.
This morning, Christ the Lord. He deserves our praise this morning. This song is called Lamb of God. Next song says, bit of a kid's song, but we'll sing it in church too for us big kids.
Oh, I will not be afraid of troubles out there night and day. Oh, I will not swamped with fear, 'cause God is always, 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 yeah, I know He's always near.
Let's
I will not be afraid. The troubles out there, night and day. Oh, I will not be swamped with fear, 'cause God is always. I don't need to worry, 'cause my God takes care of me. He gives me life, He gives me breath, yeah, everything I need. He's got all the power, and His power sees me through. He always does exactly what He says. Says He's gonna do. I will not be afraid. Oh, troubles out there, night and day. Oh, I will not be swamped with fear, 'cause God is always.
Singing. Let's pray yet before Phil comes up. Father, we want to thank You for the words of that song. It's a simple song, but it's that confidence we can have as You, as our God and our Savior, that we don't have to fear. We don't have to fear a lot of things. Things here on this earth, death, whatever might come. We know that we can have hope in You and don't have to fear. We praise You for that this morning. I pray that You bless Phil as he brings Your word to us. Just guide him as he shares and bless us as we hear and drink it in. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Going to be a little out of my element here, so if you can bear with me, I'm going to try doing a PowerPoint here in with my my message. So something I've never done. So we'll see how this goes. Can try changing the source. Okay, that's it. All right, and I want to greet you all in Jesus' name this morning, and I want to welcome each of you, visitors or regulars. I thank the Lord that each of us can be here today. I want to thank the music team for the songs, and thank you, Brandon, for doing the actions there. There's sometimes it reaches the heart a little more with some of those things, so thank you for that. Thank you, Lord, for the opening meditation and your encouragement to us there. And Lord, bless each of you for being willing to be used. So I've been felt led to share on what I will call types and shadows of the tabernacle. And I enjoy history, I guess. So hopefully this doesn't bore you all to death. But I was extremely enjoyed the study of it. And it just brought out a whole lot of things for me personally. I've always been fascinated by the tabernacle, the worship of the Israelites in the Bible. And there's a lot of things that are types of salvation and Jesus Christ himself in the tabernacle. So I was just blessed as I studied, and hopefully I can share a bit of that with you guys today. And I'm sure there'll be a lot more than what I can share with you today. So I'd encourage you, if you're interested, to study on your own in the future. So I thought I'd do a little background on this, kind of on the temple, the tabernacle. The times, I found a timeline of the Bible. So just to give you an idea when this was, when the tabernacle was built and the time frames around that, I found a timeline on a website by called the Bible Hub. So just starting out here, we'll probably all know who Abraham was, or we've heard of him in the Bible. He lived around 2100 BC, in the 2100s BC and into the 2000s BC. According to the Bible timeline, it would seem that he lived around 2,000 years after the flood. So it had been 2,000 years, after creation. Isaac was born around 2066 BC. Jacob was born around 2006 BC. And Jacob and Rachel had Joseph around 1916 BC. Joseph was sold into Egypt around 1898 BC. And then if we think of Joseph, it was because of his faithfulness where he was, in spite of his situation, that he was instrumental in saving his family from starvation during the famine in Egypt. The famine we read about in Genesis happened around 1875 BC. Around this same time, Jacob and his family moved to Egypt, to the land of Goshen. And so this is kind of the start of the children of Israel here. From that time, for around 430 years, the children of Israel lived in Egypt, according to the dates that I found in my study on the timeline. Joseph, who was well known at first, was forgotten by those in power. Meanwhile, the children of Israel were becoming strong, and because of this, the Egyptian king turned them into slaves. During this time, Moses was born. And if you remember, Moses should have been killed as a baby, because at this time the king had ordered that all Hebrew male babies were to be killed. So miraculously, Moses was saved and grew up in Pharaoh's family. So somehow he, he became one of Pharaoh's children, basically. So as he grew older, he killed an Egyptian and fled the country for his life. So around 1446 BC, Moses returned to Egypt to lead the children of Israel out of Egypt. So around 1446, so it was like 600 or 700 years after Abraham, if my figures are correct. So as we go on here, I found a timeline by a man named Rick Ashman about the Exodus by Moses and the people. He indicates that the last two plagues, the Passover, where all the firstborn of the Egyptians were killed, the Exodus and the Red Sea crossing happened in the month of April, and it would be indicated this was in 1446. The wilderness, the miracle of the quail and manna, and meeting with Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, would have happened in May of that year. They arrived at Mount Sinai, and Moses received the first copy of God's law, which he broke when he realized the people were worshiping the golden calf. This would have happened in June and July. So from late July, Moses was again up the mountain receiving a new copy of the law. Both times he was gone for 40 days. So he had been gone 40 days here. Immediately after his return, it would seem that the preparations for the tabernacle were started. And then I'll read Exodus 25, verses 1 to 9. The Lord said to Moses, "Speak to the people of Israel that they take for me a contribution from every man whose heart moves him. You shall receive the contribution for me. This is the contribution you shall receive from them: gold, silver, and bronze, blue and purple and scarlet yarns and fine twined linen, goat's hair, tanned ram skins, goat skins, acacia wood, all the lamps, all oil for the lamp, spices for the anointing oil and for the fragrant incense, onyx stones and stones for setting, for the ephod and for the breastplate. Let them make a sanctuary that I may dwell in their midst, exactly as I show you concerning the pattern of the tabernacle and of all its furniture, so you shall make it." Excuse me. As we look at the tabernacle materials, we see that the building and in most of its of the items of furniture, the common fabrication began with acacia wood. It seems that this tree grew readily in the wilderness, sometimes to a considerable height. It was not difficult to find, so it was something that they could find where they were. Whether it was the boards, the pillars, or the other items of furniture, the wood was never to be exposed by itself. It must always be overlaid with gold. The gold speaks to us of the glory of God put on display by the person of our Lord Jesus Christ in all the various facets of his human experience. The wood speaks to us of the humanity of our Lord because it was impervious to decay and of beautiful grain or texture. Our Lord's sinless and holy perfection are fully displayed in this acacia wood. The lesson here is that we can never separate the deity of Christ from his humanity. The gold overlaid the wood so that one could not see the wood without first considering the gold that overlaid it. But the gold was so thin, it was like wallpaper, that when you saw the gold, the grain of the wood was simultaneously evident through the gold. So just thinking about that, it was beautiful. At this time, God seems to have been somewhat distant. He is very much in the lives of his people, and he has indicated that they are his chosen special people. Looking at people who we've named already, we can see that they had a personal relationship of sorts with their God. We can remember Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and see the promises to them with regard to future generations, and remember Joseph, who was sold into slavery by his brothers. Can you imagine being part of a family like that? So have somebody, have your siblings sell you to slavery? Look at God's people in Egypt. They have been at the mercy of the Egyptian nations as their slaves. It may seem that God was far away, but in the case of Joseph, he didn't let circumstances dictate his life. As the Bible indicates, Joseph prospered in everything he did in spite of his situation. With regard to the Israelite people, we read in the Bible and can see that at all times, including the negative ones, God was with them. I believe the addition of the tabernacle was to help the people realize that God was physically in their midst. It was in the tabernacle that his people were the closest to him. It was a place to physically worship him. It was a physical reminder that he was in their midst. So there were three parts of the tabernacle: the Holy of Holies, which was also called the Most Holy Place, and it was separated from the other part of the tent from by a veil or a curtain. And then we had the Holy Place, which was the Holy of Holies, the Most Holy Place. Only the high priest could go there, and he went there once a year. The Holy Place was gone in by the priests as well. They could go in there at any time, I believe. And then we had the outer court. And I think so. I was going to just try and point out, see if my pointer works here. So we have the Holy of Holies and the veil, if you can kind of see what they have there. So the Holy of Holies was a cube that had the same dimensions all the way around. And then the Holy Place was the first place that you entered, and it was all entered from the court, the outer court that was around the sides and the front of the temple, or the tabernacle. All right, so the Holy of Holies, so just a few things about the Holy of Holies there, and I have some more that I'll read. The Most Holy Place was God's dwelling place and points to the holiness of God. So that was the specific place where God was, and the pillar of fire and pillar of cloud would have originated from that point, I believe. The Most Holy Place was God's dwelling place and points to the holiness of God. The dividing curtain points to the separation that exists between us and God without the plan of salvation. You will notice that the furniture in the tabernacle tent was gold, which points to the holiness of God. And I'll read Exodus 26, verses 31 to 33. And you shall make a veil of purple, of blue and purple and scarlet yarns and fine twined linen, and it shall be made with cherubim skillfully worked into it. And you shall hang it on four pillars of acacia overlaid with gold, with hooks of gold on four bases of silver. And you shall hang the veil from the clasps and bring the Ark of the Testimony in there within the veil. And the veil shall separate you from the holy place. You separate for you the holy place from the most holy. And then I'll also read Hebrews 9, 1 to 5. Now, even the first covenant had regulations for worship and an earthly place of holiness, for a tent was prepared, the first section in which were the lampstand and the table and the bread of the presence. It is called the holy place. Behind the second curtain was a second section called the most holy place, having the golden altar of incense and the Ark of the Covenant covered on all sides with gold, in which was the golden urn holding the manna, Aaron's rod Aaron's staff that bought it and the tablets of the covenant. Above it were the cherubims of gold, of glory, overshadowing the mercy seat. Of these things we cannot now speak in detail. So the room known as the Holy of Holies was the innermost and most sacred area of the ancient temple of Moses, tabernacle of Moses, and the temple of Jerusalem. The Holy of Holies was constructed as a perfect cube. It contained only the Ark of the Covenant, which is a symbol of Israel's special relationship with God. The Holy of Holies was accessible only to the Israelite high priest. Once a year on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, the high priest was permitted to enter the small windowless enclosure to burn incense and sprinkle the blood of the sacrificial animal on the mercy seat of the ark. By doing this, the high priest atoned for his own sins and for those of the people. The Holy of Holies was separated from the rest of the tabernacle and later the temple by the veil. This was a huge, heavy drape made of fine linen and blue, purple, and scarlet yarn and embroidered with cherubim. So the Ark of the Covenant, and we read about that in Exodus 25, 10 to 16. They shall make an ark of acacia wood. 2 cubits and a half shall be its length, 1.5 cubits its breadth, and 1.5 cubits its height. And you shall overlay it with pure gold. Inside and outside you shall overlay it, and you shall make on it a molding of gold around it. And you shall cast 4 rings of gold in it and put them on its 4 feet, 2 rings on one side and 2 rings on the other side of it. You shall make poles of acacia wood and overlay them with gold, and you shall put the poles into the rings on the side of the ark to carry the ark by them. The poles shall remain in the rings of the ark. They shall not be taken from it, and you shall put into the ark of the testimony that I shall give you. In Hebrews, we read that there were 3 things in the Ark of the Covenant. These things were things that represented times when God's hand was directly involved in his people. They were, 1, a jar of manna, which was the miracle food of the children of Israel, that the children of Israel ate for 40 years as they walked in the desert. So every day, except for the Sabbath day, but every day of the week, other than the Sabbath, they received this food, new every morning. So 2 was Aaron's staff that budded. This object was a proof of God's leading in the life of the children of Israel. It comes at a time when some men were revolting against the leadership of Moses and Aaron. God picked Aaron specifically to be in a position that he was in the position that he was, and the proof was a stick with no life in itself, budding and giving fruit. And that's found in Numbers 17, verse 8. On the next day, Moses went into the tent of the testimony, and behold, the staff of Aaron for the house of Levi had sprouted and put forth buds and produced blossoms, and it bore ripe almonds. And that there would have been multiple sticks there, but his was the one that God made this dead stick to bloom and blossom. And 3, the third object was the stone tablets that God had given to Moses on the mountain. These contained the law given by God to Moses for the people. These tablets were evidence of God's continued love and care for them. Unlike the false gods in the people around them who were thought to be angry if their followers did enough of the right things, he may possibly be placated. Their God was a God that was among them and told them beforehand how to be right with himself. We have the mercy seat, Exodus 25, 17 to 22. You shall make a mercy seat of pure gold. 2.5 cubits shall be its length, 1.5 cubits its breadth, and you shall make 2 cherubims of gold. Of hammered work shall you make them on the ends of the mercy seat. Make one cherub on the one end and one cherub on the other. Of one piece with the mercy seat shall you make the cherubim on its two ends. The cherubim shall spread out their wings above, overshadowing the mercy seat with their wings. Their faces one to another toward the mercy seat shall face. Towards the mercy seat shall the faces of the cherubim be. And you shall put the mercy seat on top of the ark, and in the ark put the testimony that I shall give you. There I will meet you, and from above the mercy seat, from between the two cherubim that are on the ark of the testimony, I will speak with you about all that I've given you in commandment for the people of Israel. And the other piece there that we read about in Leviticus is the golden censer, and that's found in Leviticus 16, 12, and 13. And he shall take a censer full of coals of fire from the altar before the Lord, and two handfuls of sweet incense beaten small, and he shall bring it inside the veil and put the incense on the fire before the Lord, and the cloud of the incense may cover the mercy seat that is over the testimony, so that he will not die. So that was something that needed to be done. So we're going to the holy place. Upon entry, you will notice that common worshipers did not enter the tabernacle tent, only the priests. Once inside the holy place, the priest would see the table of showbread to their right, a golden lampstand to their left, and an altar of incense ahead, just in front of the veil, separating the two chambers. In the holy place, priests acted as representatives of the people of Israel before God. They placed 12 loaves of unleavened bread, representing the 12 tribes, on the table. The bread was removed every Sabbath and eaten by the priests inside the holy place and replenished with new loaves. Priests also tended the golden lampstand inside the holy place. Since there were no windows or openings, the front veil was kept closed. This would have been their only source of light. On the third instrument, the altar of incense, the priest burned sweet-smelling incense every morning and evening. The smoke from the incense rose to the ceiling and went through the opening above the veil and filled the Holy of Holies during the high priest's annual rite. As a repentant sinner entered the tabernacle courtyard and walked forward, he drew closer and closer to the physical presence of God, who manifested himself inside the Holy of Holies in a pillar of cloud and fire. When we look at the Old Testament, we see that a believer could only draw so close to God. Then he or she had to be represented by a priest or a high priest the rest of the way. God knew that his chosen people were superstitious, barbaric, and easily influenced by their idol-worshiping neighbors. He gave them the law, the judges, prophets, and kings to prepare them for a savior. So this points ahead to the perfect moment in time when Jesus Christ, that Savior, entered the world. When he died for humanity's sins, the veil of the Jerusalem temple was split from top to bottom, showing the end of the separation between God and his people. It was at this point that our bodies changed from holy places to the Holy of Holies, when the Holy Spirit comes to live within us, so we can be that most holy place. We are made worthy for God to dwell within us, not by our own sacrifices or good works, like the people who worshipped in the tabernacle, but by the saving death of Jesus. God credits Jesus' righteousness to us through his gift of grace, entitling us to eternal life with him in heaven. So just a few things about the outer court. So it was 100 cubits by 50 cubits, which would work out to about 150 feet by 75 feet. The outer court was surrounding the temple. On the north and south sides stood 20 bronze pillars supporting a long curtain made of fine fine woven linen. On the east and west sides, each had 10 bronze pillars. But while the west side was a full 50 cubits of linen, the east side had a gate in the middle. The gate was made of blue, purple, and scarlet threads in fine woven linen. It's interesting to see what this part of the tabernacle was made of and what it looked like, but we may ask, what does that have to do with me? As the first part of the tabernacle that a person would have encountered who wanted to approach God, the outer court represents the first stage of any Christian life, and that is finding Christ. One of the most prominent features of the outer court was the many, many feet of fine linen, which stretched around the entire structure of the tabernacle. According to the Bible, fine linen is often associated with a person who shows fine, righteous humanity. And we find in Revelation, or we'll read Revelation 19, 7 and 8. Let us rejoice and exult and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted to her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure, for the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. Jesus Christ, as God in the flesh, represents the highest degree of humanity. When he walked on the earth, he embodied compassion and love for all kinds of people. From tax collectors to sinners, from lepers to Pharisees, Jesus taught, cared for, and healed and forgave countless people who came to him. Just as the outer court would be the first encounter of God, encounter a God-seeking man would find, so too the humanity of believers is the first thing we encounter when seeking God today. Fine linen curtains do not by themselves allow a person entrance to the tabernacle. That function is reserved for the gate. This gate is distinct from the rest of the linen because it has blue, purple, and scarlet threads woven throughout. This gate is a singular entrance to the dwelling place of God. Anyone who wants to interact with God, to make offerings to him, or to be where his glory was, needed to go through the gate. There was no other way. In the gate, we see blue, the color of the sky, representing a heavenly nature. We also see purple, which is the color of royalty, and we find that in John 19, 2 and 3, and it shows kingship. We even see scarlet portraying redemption, and we find that in Isaiah 1, verse 18, Matthew 27, verse 28, and 1 Peter 2, 24. Finally, we again see the fine linen showing the highest human virtues. Jesus Christ matches all of this. In John 1, we find Jesus was in the beginning with God and was himself God. That is, he was heavenly, and we find that in John 1, verses 1 and 2. In Matthew, we find that Jesus is king, found again in Matthew 27, 11. Throughout the New Testament, we see that we were redeemed by his blood, and we find that in Romans 3, 24, Ephesians 1, 7, Hebrews 9, 11 and 12. Jesus testified about himself, saying, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And that's found in John 14, verse 6. Jesus is the way to the Father. He is the gateway to every stage of our Christian life. We receive redemption and eternal life through him and through him alone. As Peter testified in Acts, nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. And we can find that in Acts 4, verse 12. There is no other way. So we'll look at the utensils of the outer court, the furniture. In this area, any metal you would see would have been bronze. It would seem, based on reading through its usage, that the potentially bronze indicates the physical or earthly realm. and spoken of in the Bible as God's footstool. It would also have a certain level of purification through the earthly sacrifices. This would allow followers into the outer court of the tabernacle, but no further. Into the holy places of the higher levels of purification are required, represented by the silver and gold. So a certain amount of purification had to happen to make this bronze. And then if we look at the people who were sacrificed for, the children of Israel, they could go into the outer court. There was a certain level of purification there. As you approach the gate of the tabernacle and stepped inside, you would see a large altar of bronze. And I'll read Exodus 27, 1-8. You shall make the altar of acacia wood 5 cubits long and 5 cubits broad. The altar shall be square, and its height shall be 3 cubits. And you shall make horns for it on its 4 corners. Its horns shall be of 1 piece with it. And you shall overlay it with bronze. And you shall make pots for it to receive its ashes, and shovels and basins and forks and fire pans. And you shall make all its utensils of bronze. And you shall make it for it a grating, a network of bronze. And on the net you shall make 4 bronze rings at its 4 corners. And you shall set it under the ledge of the altar, so that the net extends halfway down the altar. And you shall make poles for the altar, poles of acacia wood, and overlay them with bronze. And the poles shall be put through the rings, so that the poles are on 2 sides of the altar when it is carried. And you shall make it hollow with boards, as it has been shown you on the mountain, so shall it be made. So bronze is a symbol of the judgment for sin, bronze judgment, and it is able to withstand fire and an indication of divinity. So the dimensions being 5 by 5 by 3, that would work out to around 7.5 feet square by 4 feet high or so. I think I have that in here somewhere. And I'm not sure. The brazen altar, or bronze altar, or altar of sacrifice, was situated right inside the courtyard upon entering the gate of the tabernacle. The Hebrew root for altar means to slay or slaughter. The Latin word alta means high. An altar is a high place for sacrifice and or slaughter. The altar stood raised on a mound of earth higher than its surrounding furniture. This is looking forward to Christ, our sacrifice, lifted up on the cross. His altar stood on a hill called Golgotha. The altar was a symbol of made of wood from the acacia tree and overlaid with bronze, usually symbolic of judgment on sin in the Bible, measuring 7.5 feet all on all 4 sides and 4.5 feet deep. 4 horns projected from the top, 4 corners, and a bronze grating inside to hold the animal. The altar was the place for burning animal sacrifices. It showed the Israelites that the first step for sinful man to approach a holy God was to be cleansed by the blood of an innocent creature. For a sin offering, a person had to bring an animal, a male one, without blemish or defect from the flock or herd to the priest at the tabernacle gate. This is pointing toward Jesus as he approached his death. He was indeed innocent with regard to God and his Father. He was perfect and without blemish, without sin. So looking at the physical sacrifice here, and reading from Leviticus 1, verse 4, He is to lay his hand on the head of the burnt offering, and it will be accepted on his behalf to make atonement for him. So the person that brought the animal laid their hand on the sacrifice animal. By laying his hand upon the head of the offering, the person was identifying with the sacrifice. His sin and guilt was being moved from himself to the animal. The priest would then slaughter the animal, sprinkling its blood on the front of the veil of the holy place, burn the sacrifice, and pour the rest of it at the bottom of the altar. The blood is a significant agent of atonement or covering for sin and cleansing in the Old Testament. Okay, I think I should have. So just a reminder that it's a reminder of Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. And then a few things here. I'll just let you read that. Leviticus 6, verse 9, and then the fire happened at all times, was continuing. It talks about it being all night, and it was just happening all the time. It foreshadows the work of the Holy Spirit, so the work of the Holy Spirit happens at all times. And there's some verses there. So going to the brazen or the bronze laver, it was a basin basically that held clean water. Exodus 30, 17 to 21. The Lord said to Moses, "You shall also make a basin of bronze and with its stand of bronze for washing, and you shall put it between the tent of meeting and the altar, and you shall put water in it, with which Aaron and his sons shall wash their hands and feet when they go into the tent of meeting, or when they come near to the altar to minister, to burn a food offering to the Lord. They shall wash with water so that they may not die, and they shall wash their hands and their feet so that they may not die. It shall be a statute forever to them, even to him and to his offspring throughout their generations." And also Exodus 38, verse 8, "He made the basin of bronze and its stand of bronze from mirrors of the ministering women who ministered in the entrance of the tent of meeting." The thought is that these were possibly mirrors that the Israelite women would have gotten from the Egyptian women as they left Egypt. This concept is interesting, as a mirror is the only way for us to see our own appearance. God does not look on us to see if we are outwardly clean and prepared for the world. He requires us to be inwardly clean. God demands holiness. It is not the sacrifice of bulls, goats, or lambs that God desires for us. He looks at the heart. Regeneration and sanctification are needed to make a person beautiful inside. The bronze laver was God's wonderful provision for that inner cleansing. It stood between the bronze altar and the entrance into the holy place. At the laver, the priest was to wash his hands and his feet before he could enter the holy place to serve God. No priest was permitted to enter into the holy place with unclean feet or hands. If he did so, he would die. The washing by the priests in the tabernacle symbolized great certain truths. First of all, true washing must come from God. Aaron and his sons were to wash themselves at the bronze altar in the tabernacle. They were not to wash themselves in their own homes. Instead, the washing had to be done in the sanctuary of God. Self-purification will not do. We cannot cleanse ourselves from the defilements of sin. Sin is not skin deep, as some may suppose, that it can be washed away by the touch of our hands and a bar of soap. The stain of sin is dark and deep in our very nature, and only the cleansing done through the blood of the Savior can wash it away. So when we looked at, or when we look at John 13, 5 to 10, it's Jesus, when he was instituting communion, he's talking to his disciples and practicing communion. And he says, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. So this washing needs to happen to be part with Christ. And repentance and confession must be before communion with God. So blood and water, and we read about this, it's kind of a foreshadowing of Jesus when he died. John 19, 34 and 35, but one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you also may believe. So the gate of the temple, read Exodus 27, 16 to 18. For the gate of the court, there shall be a screen 20 cubits long, of blue and purple and scarlet yarns, fine twisted linen, embroidered with needlework. It shall have four pillars with them four bases. All the pillars around the court shall be filleted with silver. Their hooks shall be silver and their bases of bronze. The length of the court shall be 100 cubits, the breadth 50 cubits, the height 55 cubits, and with hanging of fine twined linen and bases of bronze. So the dimensions, 5 cubits high, 20 cubits wide. It was hung on four pillars, and that would kind of indicate the four corners of the earth. It's a screen. Those outside cannot see what's inside unless they enter, and that verse from Psalm 45 there. The gate was a screen, not a door. It wasn't made of wood or bronze. It was always open, not secure by itself, so it wouldn't stop anything from going in. But God is the protector. And we read in Psalm 127, verse 1, unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. The one and only gate to the tabernacle is a representation of Christ as the only way through which someone could fellowship with God and worship Him. To do this, someone needed to enter through the gate to the place where God dwelled. Christ is the gate. Beautiful symbolism can be found in both the outer fence and the gate of the tabernacle that point us to the Lord Jesus Christ. As we draw closer to the Savior, one of the first things that often will catch our eye is His purity and perfection, symbolized by the white linen fence. In many ways, we may want to turn away because of our lack of cleanliness, but the Lord beckons us forward, showing us how we can become pure like He is pure. The colors of the outer gate can likewise symbolize the perfection and attributes of the Savior. The color blue in ancient times often symbolizing heaven. The color purple, royalty. The color red, death, blood, mortality, and sacrifice. These same colors will be replicated throughout the temple. The act of entering the gate of the temple was significant to the Israelites. By entering, they could find forgiveness of sin and fellowship with God. The first thing that was seen on entering through the gate was the brazen altar, which served as a reminder of man's sinfulness and his need for a blood sacrifice in order to be in fellowship with God. They needed to repent and offer sacrifices for their sins. Those who did not repent could not enter this narrow way, as the Bible speaks of the narrow way. So the tent and its coverings. So it's representative of Christ. And read Exodus 26, verse 1. Moreover, you shall make the tabernacle with 10 curtains of fine twined linen, blue and purple and scarlet yarns. You shall make them with cherubim skillfully worked into them. And then we have goat's hair. Actually, I'll go to the next slide. Has different covers there. Exodus 26, verse 7. You shall also make curtains of goat's hair for a tent over the tabernacle. 11 curtains shall you make. And then we have two layers of ram skins and goat skins. It talks about goat skins. There's difference of opinion on that. And we'll get into that a little more. Exodus 26, verse 14. And you shall make for the tent a covering of tanned ram skins and a covering of goat skins on top. The outermost covering is referred to as goat skins in the ESV. It is also referred to in the King James Version as as badger skin. It is thought that it was probably marine mammal skins, possibly a dolphin or a manatee family. It was probably selected because of its durability. This layer would take the punishment of the elements. It is estimated to have required 1,000 to 1,500 skins to make. This outer covering was very plain by world standards and reminds us of the words of the prophet Isaiah as he speaks of the coming Messiah. And I'll read Isaiah 53, verses 1 to 3. Who has believed what he has heard from us, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, like a root out of a dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hid their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. The second layer was of ram skins. The second covering was the ram skin dyed red. This is to remind us of the sacrifice of Jesus and the shedding of his precious blood. The rams had to die before the skins could be obtained. These red ram skins covered the entire tabernacle. This may be taken to represent the fact that the precious blood of Jesus must cover and protect everything connected with the life of the believer. I'll read Isaiah 53, verse 7. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. And also 1 Peter 1, 18 and 19. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversations received by the traditions of your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without blemish and without spot. Peter is telling us here that the blood of the Messiah only redeems us, nothing else. So the third layer was goat's hair, and this was black. The third covering was black goat's hair. It was made of 11 individual goat hair curtains and measured 30 cubits by 4 cubits wide, each curtain. The covering was divided into two sections, the front half being made of 6 curtains and the back half of 5 curtains. Along each inside edge of the two halves were 50 loops connected by 50 copper or brass hooks. Notice that the black, which makes us think of sin, is covered by the red, which symbolizes Jesus' blood. Jesus' blood covers our sin. In fact, it washes them away. Hallelujah. The goat's hair covering reminds us of the most holy day of the year, Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. On that day, two goats were used as part of one offering to God. This is why there were two sections of the covering, each for one goat. One for each goat. One goat was slain, and the high priest sprinkled its blood on the mercy seat. From the time of Adam and Eve's original sin until the time of Jesus, we see a trail of blood sacrifice. And we'll read Hebrews 9, verse 22. And almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood is no remission. The high priest laid his hands on the head of the second goat, the scapegoat, and confessed the sins of the people of Israel. It was then let go into the inhabited wilderness. The sins of the people were covered only. This process did not take them away. This is why the sacrifice had to be repeated. After Jesus died in our place and took on himself the sins of the world, it was no longer necessary to repeat the sacrifice for sin. So going on to the fourth layer, the twisted fine linen. The fourth and innermost cover was made of linen. It was the only covering that could be seen from the inside of the tabernacle. It was embroidered in blue, purple, and scarlet with the design of cherubim. I believe that it was beautiful to see, but was not seen by all. The significance of blue, purple, scarlet, and white are the same as discussed in the door section. Again, blue refers to heaven. The purple speaks of Jesus' deity. The scarlet refers to Jesus' blood. The white refers to the purity of Jesus. The use of cherubim were to remind Israel that one day they would be associated with angels. Everyone was involved in the building of the temple, and we already read some of the verses. People were to bring parts and pieces together, and then everyone was involved. And I think that could speak to the church as well. The believer must be an active member of the church and work in abundance. Everyone is needed, so no one is not needed. So which direction was it facing? It was facing west, and I don't think I have the verses right here with me, but you were headed east as you were headed west as you were entering the temple. It was facing east. And going back to the Garden of Eden, man was cast out of the garden and would have had to head west to go back towards Eden again. And in history, west would have been heading towards God and east would have been heading away from God. So the tabernacle was raised up in the first month of the second year of the Exodus. So it would have been after, so in 1447, I guess, B.C. It took 9 months to build it, and it was set in the middle of the camp, surrounded by the priests and the Levites, and then outside of that was each of the 12 tribes, three on each side of the tabernacle. And just a rendition of what it may have looked like, considering that this was God's people. God was in the center of his people here as he dwelt in the temple, in the tabernacle. Exodus 25, verse 8, and let them make a sanctuary that I may dwell in their midst. God was a very personal God. Exodus 29, 45, and 46. Let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell in their midst. And then 2 Corinthians 6, verse 16. What agreement has the temple of God with idols? For we are the temple of the living God. As God said, I will make my dwelling among them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. So God was living close to them, but in our situation today, God dwells inside of us. He will dwell inside of us. John 1, verse 1 and verse 14, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The word dwelt here is tabernacled. Jesus was the Word, and He was and is God. Just as during the time of the tabernacle and the temple, the Holy Spirit dwelt in the tabernacle, which is our hearts today. So Jesus dwells and is tabernacled with us today. So, Exodus 40, 33 to 35, and he erected the court around the tabernacle and the altar and set up the screen of the gate of the court. So Moses finished the work. Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And Moses was not able to enter the tent of meeting because the cloud settled on it. And the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And then 2 Chronicles 7, verses 1 and 2, speaking about the temple. As soon as Solomon finished his prayer, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices. And the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And the priests could not enter the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord filled the Lord's house. In closing, as we look at the response of God to this and also the temple, I'm struck by his bringing down his glory. See Moses at the tabernacle and the priests at the temple. None of them were able to enter the structures because of God's glory. God's presence and specifically his glory indicate that he was happy with the work. He put his stamp of approval on it as he inhabited it. We, because of Jesus and his death and resurrection, are able to stand in his presence, unlike Moses and the priests who could not approach God. And I'll maybe just read this other. So God showed his glory on a daily basis to the children of Israel here. And I'll read that in Exodus 40, 36 to 38, I believe is what these verses are. Throughout all their journeys, whenever the cloud was taken up from over the tabernacle, the people of Israel would set out. But if the cloud was not taken up, then they did not set out until the day that it was taken up. For the cloud of the Lord was above the tabernacle by day, and the fire was in it by night, in the sight of all the house of Israel throughout all their journeys. And they kept the charge of the Lord. Complete obedience was the requirement for God's continued blessing and presence. And the same is today. So I hope you enjoyed this study. It was good for me to study it for myself. And I'd encourage you to study it for yourself, as there is a lot more there than what I was able to share. So may the Lord bless you all in the coming weeks. Let's just have a word of prayer now as we close. Our Father in heaven, I thank you for who you are. Thank you for what you've left on record for us. Thank you for the tabernacle and the types and shadows that are left there. Thank you for the blessing of being able to study this and just encourage us to see you and see Christ and his blood and what that means to us. And just help us to show that to the world around us. Help us to be a blessing. In the coming week, help us to love you more than anything else and to grow to be more like you. Bless us now and keep us today, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, I invite you to stand for our closing song. Let's sing the song, Thy Word. Thy Word is a Lamp.
Thy Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto
week.